I can't hear you.
Sir, I understand you have a witness statement you desire to read to the committee.
That's correct, sir.
First,
that's correct. Thank you.
Not a move, and they can't hear what we're saying.
I wonder about this Senator, please.
I'm not sure they can hear anything.
I wonder if you would mind letting.
This is the first opportunity I've had to speak to the representatives of the American people. I propose to give an account of my stewardship as Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet. Keep the fleet in Hawaiian waters. The fleet was not ready for war in 1940. I set out to make it ready. This required an intensive training program. In carrying out this program, we were handicapped by the detachment from time to time of officers and men in large numbers to meet the demands of the expanding procurement and training agencies on shore and the supply of trained personnel to man new ships. My concern about this is reflected in my correspondence in 1941. On February 7, in an official letter to the Chief of Naval Training of ships, divisions, and squadrons as part of the fleet as a whole. New weapons and new technique were an everyday product of the war in Europe.
New methods
had to be devised, tested, and perfected to meet new threats. For instance, the anti-aircraft defense of large formations had to be improved to meet possible Japanese air tactics in the event of war. Our previous training, chiefly protect the territory of the associated powers in the Pacific area, K-Task, route shipping of associated powers, all of the ships of the fleet in Pearl Harbor. It was recognized that the Pacific Fleet was inferior to the Japanese fleet in every category of fighting ship. No one in authority expected that the Pacific Fleet could meet the Japanese head on. Admiral King's official report, after I organized the fleet in three major task forces, I attempted to keep two of the three forces at sea and only one in Pearl Harbor. I quickly found that fuel deliveries were falling behind consumption. The reserves were being depleted at a time when it was imperative to increase them. It was this fact, and this alone, which made it necessary to have two task forces simultaneously in Pearl Harbor at certain periods. It was not advisable and the accomplishment of necessary work on the ships. At the time of the attack, the orders in effect required that one-fourth to one-half of the anti-aircraft guns, depending upon the type of ships, be manned at all times in port. At the time of the attack, the guns were so manned. Admiral Inglis has testified that on the morning of the attack, all the anti-aircraft batteries on all the ships were manned and firing within 4 to 7 minutes. The men of the fleet on December 7th made the transition from peace to war with speed and courage. I might add that immediately installed torpedo baffles appears to have been made by the Navy Department. My relations with General Short, which were once the subject of considerable confusion in the public mind, have now been clarified by exhaustive investigations. The committee has all the evidence on this subject. I need not labor it. It has been established that our official and social relations were friendly, that we frequently conferred on official matters of common interest, and invariably did so when either of us received messages which had any bearing on the development of the United States-Japanese situation or on our several plans in preparing for war. As in the Hawaiian Islands, I gave General Short all the assistance I could even in connection with local defensive measures, which were exclusively under the Army's control. Aircraft warning service is a case in point. I took Army personnel to sea with the fleet so that they could be trained as radar operators. I assigned to the Army a naval officer who had experience in Britain with radar to give any advice and assistance he could in connection with the aircraft warning net in Hawaii. General Short, the Army's radar was manned. It was so manned. It was only the day before the attack that some subordinate Army officer gave the permission to shut down at 7 a.m. on Sunday. Even despite this, one of the stations was operating after 7 a.m. on the morning of December 7th and obtained information both about the incoming and outgoing planes. This information was not passed to the Navy. Efforts to prepare the fleet for war. Local alert against attack. In the year 1941, the international situation was grave and at times tense. However, preparing the fleet for war through an intensive training program had to go on. There was a vital element of timing involved in determining when the fleet should curtail training for all-out war measures. Maximum security measures, consistent with the maintenance of the training program, were already in effect in the fleet. When would Japanese-American relations reach the point that all training should cease and all-out dispositions should be made? This was what we needed to know in the Pacific in the year 1941. Further, the order to mobilize was not given. In the dispatches I received on and after October 16, 1941, I was not given available information as to the actual status of Japanese-American negotiations and as to Japanese military plans, nor was I given orders for alert against an attack on Hawaii. These dispatches had the same tenor as the warnings which had previously been sent in February, June, and July 1941, predicting probable Japanese action thousands of miles from the Hawaiian area. Two, despite the Navy Department had several courses open. It could furnish me directly with the best evidence of Japanese intentions and plans, the intercepted Japanese military and diplomatic messages. This would have given me an opportunity to judge for myself the gravity and intensity of the crisis as December 7, 1941 approached, and the probability of a Japanese attack on Hawaii. The Navy Department failed to do this. The Navy Department did not permit me to evaluate for myself the intercepted Japanese military and diplomatic messages. We maintain, as a regular procedure, a high state of daily alertness, which within a very short time could be intensified to deal with a particular hazard when and if it developed.
I do.
From time to time, as circumstances require.